your Basketball Coaches Association and some other committee members are here. So I'm going to talk for about, hopefully just 15, 20 minutes about the realignment proposal, which I believe most of you are familiar with. Has anybody here not ever heard that idea before? The realignment proposal.
There's around 10, 15 new coaches, I promise.
10, 15 new coaches, okay. So I'm going to give you a little bit of background and then take in what it is. So as you know, and you heard me talk at the coaches' meeting, everything we do has to go back to what our mission is here for education-based athletics. Okay, so if you're not 100% familiar with the DIA mission, it's right on the homepage of our website, but I always want this to be our starting point, because every decision we make, everything we do, should be in line with what our mission is of education-based athletics. Okay, so some of the things, you know, promote educational significance, stay compatible with the educational mission of our member schools. This is the one we're going to reflect on the most today. Provide fair competition between member schools. That's what we're going to keep coming back to. That's what this whole idea is about. Promote sportsmanship. Wrong way. Establish and enforce conduct codes, physical well-being of athletes. That's another big one for this presentation. And promote healthy adolescent lifestyles. So to give you a little bit of history, before I took this job at DIAA, I was at St. Mark's for 23 years. And during that time, I coached softball at Middletown. So I was in the Blue Hen Conference. I was the administrator that oversaw athletics, and I sat on the DIAA board for 8 years, the last 3.5, which I was the chair. So a lot of familiarity, I'm not going to say the big words today, sorry, with a lot of the things that were going on. And what I kept seeing was coaches in schools complaining why they couldn't build a schedule. Nobody wants to play me because I'm too good. Nobody wants to play me because I'm too bad. I can't play you because I won't get in the tournament. I'm not going to make up that game because if I make up that game, then my points aren't right and I can get in the tournament. I won't get in the tournament. We've heard that all the time. Then we had committees coming in saying we want a tournament of 16 teams. We want a tournament of 24 teams. I want a tournament of 20 teams. We want to go Division 1 and 2. We want to just be one division. Heard all that. And all these things kept coming up, and I said one day at a board meeting, I said, "What, you know, why isn't every member school have equal opportunity to create a schedule that works for them and that isn't impeded by all these things about getting into the tournaments? And why are everybody complaining?" The other thing was everybody always saying, "I don't know what it takes to get in the tournament. This tournament index is this way. This tournament index is this way. If I lose this game, I get more points than if I win this game." So that was the third part of it. So this idea of the difficulty scheduling, the getting in and out of the tournaments, the manipulating of schedules to get into the tournaments, all that was kind of just swirling around over and over again. And I said, isn't there something we can do as the overseeing organization of all this to kind of get rid of some of these issues? So we, the board created a committee, the realignment committee. And it was made up of one representative of every one of the conferences and some non-conference representatives. So some of the papers that I passed out earlier and in the past tell you who's on the committee. So Andy Dick, Mike Hart, Bob Salento, I'm trying to go through the conferences real quick, Joe Thompson, Dave Oswinkle, Gary Smaglia from the board, Kevin Smith joined the committee recently. So we could talk about what can we do from the big DIA perspective to assist in scheduling, to make tournaments, you know, easier to understand how you get in, to eliminate this scheduling of who I want to play and who I don't want to play. What can we do? And we tossed around lots and lots of ideas. So the goal of what we wanted to do was to solve these issues. Look at the impact of scheduling on tournament berths and seating. Because you know, if you can create a good schedule, you can get into the tournament. Not everybody has the same opportunity to build a schedule, build a good schedule. We know that being in a conference or not being in a conference can go both ways, help you or hurt you, depending on what sport you're in and where you are. Again, like I said, lots of tournaments wanted to reformat, expand, and all that. And the other big thing that we can't ignore is that DIA looks very different now than it did when many of these tournament committees were started, many of these options were created. Okay, we have 61 high schools now, only 24 of which are your traditional public school. Okay, we have the charter schools, the VOTEC schools, and the non-public schools that are just right there with the non-public. So that creates differences in the student population. School sizes are all very different, okay? And everybody's educational mission can be different. Okay, so as the landscape our high schools have changed. Unfortunately, we haven't changed any way we're doing business on this end. Okay, and what I always say is we want to think beyond the box here. This isn't just about who's going to win the state championship. And I know when you get a group of coaches in the room, that's the first thing on your mind, right? Am I going to win my state championship? But a lot of times you have to take a step back, look at the big picture, look at our mission, and say, how can we impact every student athlete in the state who wants to play this game and have a good, rewarding experience? Fair competition for everyone, okay? And then create opportunities for them to win a state championship, too. So part of our goal also was to improve the scheduling process. Like I said, hearing ADs complain all the time and even coaches complain. We want to create a schedule that's built on the competitiveness level of your team. Not necessarily just on what conference you're in because of where you're geographically located and because of how many students you have in your building. Okay, we want to create a schedule that's going to have you have competition that's on your level. We also want to recognize and allow for the traditional rivalries. They're obviously very, very important. Like I said, I spent 23 years at St. Mark's. We want the opportunity every year to maintain our rivalry with Salesiana. We don't want to be locked out from playing the traditional rivalry. We know some of the schools in Brandywine School District are obligated to play each other. We want those things to happen. There's a lot of that on downstate too. We want to maintain traditional rivalries, and we want equal opportunity in scheduling. So if I have an open week and nobody else has an open week, how does that help me? Okay, but if we all have the same open week together, then we can all schedule each other. Okay, if I need five games, but you only need one game, okay, we want equal opportunity. So it's same number of games, same open weeks. So how can we create that? So that was another one of our goals. Again, education-based athletics, student participation and motivation. Nobody wants to go out year after year and get beat up on. Okay? And I applaud the coaches and I've coached against them. I've been that coach sometimes, that it's hard to get the team motivated to go out because they don't think they have a chance to win this game. Okay? So when you're building a new program, when you've cycled out some talent, you're cycling a new talent, we want to put you in a position where you can be successful. And I know successful just isn't wins and losses, okay? But we want to be able for them to walk out of the field, look onto the court, and feel like we have a chance to be competitive today, okay? Create more opportunities for some championships. I know the biggest concern of the coaches, and it's down here on the list of concerns later, is we're just going to water down the state championship, okay? But giving everybody an opportunity to compete for a state championship is what the goal is, okay? It's going to be a different level. It's going to be a different mindset, but we want to create opportunities here. And again, provide fair competition. There's so much disparity within conferences, between conferences, different parts of the state. Okay, we want to try to eliminate some of that by creating a schedule that you can play to be competitive almost every day you walk out in the field. And then we want to address the tournament committees. Obviously, like I said, that's not all we're about. That's a big part of what we're about. That creates excitement. We just finished an awesome tournament. We had great excitement. We're doing everything we can here in the DIA office to promote that excitement. So we value the tournaments. Okay, we want them to be exciting. Okay, but we want to get rid of all this nonsense that kind of goes on between them sometimes. Okay, the schedule manipulating and the I don't understand this and we don't understand that. So how can we get, you know, increase the opportunity to work the system, make speeding understandable for the entire community. You don't need to have a PhD in math to figure out if you made it into the tournament or not. Okay, it should be pretty cut and dry. So those were our goals. We looked a lot at Division I and Division II. It's successful in some sports that it's taking place in. Field hockey just went to it. Football has done it for a while. Wrestling, track and field. Okay, there are obviously advantages to having Division I and Division II. But remember, it's only based on enrollment. Okay, it's not any level of competitiveness involved there. The tournaments that switched D1 and D2, they did. They gave more teams opportunities to get into the tournament. They increased the number of state championships, so those are two very important goals. However, doesn't impact the scheduling process. All the mistakes, not all the trauma of scheduling process is still there, and it does not create equitable competition. And those are two of our big goals also. Okay. So this is all the things we kept looking at. We looked at lots of different models. We looked at open tournaments. We create all these different things. I don't even remember what they did because this has been a topic of conversation for a good 3.5, close to 4 years. And it's a good conversation. And I think because it's lasted that long, there's enough good to it that has kept it moving along. But there's a lot of, I understand, change of mindset, thinking outside the box, okay? Fear of change associated with it too. So we haven't had the chance to take the leap and try it out. So all my years at the board, we gave two-year pilot programs lots of things. Baseball to expand their tournament, volleyball to expand their tournament, field hockey right now to do the D1, D2. So what the realignment committee said is, we just want a two-year trial period to try this out. So we can see if it addresses the things we want to address, or if it's an epic fail. Okay, but we want the opportunity to try it out. So we've been around to coaches associations for football before we came to you. You guys have seen this in the past. We've talked to the board, we've talked to the AD, we've talked to head of schools. Now we're talking to you. We're gonna lay it all out there so you all hear the same message. Then this whole message is gonna go out to everybody, and we want your input back so the board of directors, the IAA board, can say, let's give it a go, or let's put it to bed and try a different way to resolve these issues. Okay, so that's why we're here today. We're asking for a pilot program. I'm gonna pass some stuff out to you in a second. So what we landed on is very similar to what's called the Rhode Island model. Dave Oswinkle and Gary Smaglia both came from Rhode Island at some point, and they said this is how they do it in Rhode Island. So Rhode Island is a small state like us, okay? So we felt like let's look at it and see how it works. So instead of just basing where you are on your school enrollment, it's based on your population, your winning percentage over 7 years, and your winning percentage over 3 years, 60, 20, and 20. And then you rank all the schools according to those criteria, and I'm gonna pass it out because we've done it for girls basketball and boys basketball. I'm gonna pass it out to you in a second. And then based on that, you rank everybody, you put them into classes and districts, and you build your schedules based on that. You play in tournaments based on that, okay? So that's the big picture model. How does this go? We need to decide now because we want to implement this for 19-20 because it's gonna take us some work to get it done. So there's kind of like five steps: collecting data, creating classes, making schedules, adjusting it, and improving it by the board. The very first thing that you can say right from the get-go, before any of this calculation is done, before any of the math is done, you can say, look, I don't care what my numbers are, I want to be in class AAA. Okay? I want to compete at that level, I believe in my team, I'm going to be up there. And your school can petition to be in that. You petition to the sports committee. Anybody can petition to be in the top class. Then the sports committees run all the numbers, they make all the calculations, they do the initial classes and districts, and then they send it out to the schools. Then you can see where you sit, and you say, that works for me. Or you might say, no, it doesn't work for me. I just graduated all those kids, I'm really not that good. I think I should go to class AA. Or no, we're competitive, we're bringing it in, and I want to go up to class AAA. So you have, again, flexibility to move around a little bit. So it takes the good part of the math, it combines it with some of the subjectivity of a group of people who are knowledgeable in this area, and they will, making sure everything is balanced, create the final classes and districts, and then build a schedule, switch in north-south, build a schedule, if that gets approved by the board of directors. We hand that schedule over to your ADs, they fill in the blanks, you have a schedule, and from that we move on to the tournament, okay? It's a very quick description of the process because I know you want to see it rather than just having to talk about it. Again, I mentioned the sports committee. So right now we have a great group of volunteers that run all of our tournaments. We are still going to need them, and we're going to need those groups to expand. So an opportunity to get some more coaches and ADs involved, because we're going to need like two groups, really. One group is going to do all the indexing and scheduling and sending it out, and then the second group still needs to be there to run the tournament. So those are the people who are going to take over that. They're going to create the classes and districts, create the schedule. They're going to take over some of the governance of the sports. Some of those rules that, you know, this conference plays this rule, okay, 6-minute quarter, 8-minute quarters, okay, I would say for softball, mercy rule, when do we implement the international tiebreaker? All those things would be established by these sports committees and be consistent throughout all the state, okay? They would also do your tournament seeding and playoff structure and run the tournaments. So these are when we talked about this, and many times we talked about this, these are the concerns that come up, okay? And we recognize that they're there, but these are the ones we want to see, you know, if we can, you know, have the good outweigh the concerns. We understand you could change travel, okay? But when we tried to break down the schedules, and I'll show you, we tried to divide class teams into north and south so your travel isn't as impacted as much, and we did some numbers on that. Again, diluting the state championship. It's just going to be a different mindset. In Delaware right now, we're in the mindset that there's one state championship in basketball for boys and there's one state championship basketball for girls. It's going to take a while for us to change that mindset, and I don't think we're ever going to dilute it. I don't think D1, D2 diluted field hockey. I don't think it diluted wrestling when it went to that. Everybody's just as happy to win whatever, wherever they are. We don't want to lose the tradition of the conferences. The intent of this was never to blow up the conferences. Somebody said that someplace, so she just wants to blow up the conferences. Number one, it's not what I want to do. This is a whole group of people, a committee, okay? And we want to, again, improve the education-based athletics, fair competition, health and safety. Because again, some of those games you go out, I know I was a third base coach. I was afraid sometimes that I was going to get hit really hard down third baseline because we're in a game that it's not really fair competition. Guys, we understand the governance of the conferences, but we want to change, put that over to the tournament committees. And then this is the question people want to know, and this came from the football people. You know, Del Mar, great year, 10-0. What if they go 10-0 next year again? Because, I mean, they have to go up and play a schedule, and they have to play Middletown and Smyrna and Sally's every week? No, okay? Because after right now, we're using websites for sports data. All the data that I'm going to pass out to you in a little bit is all based on websites for sports. But as we roll into this, and now we're into this for 2 years, we take over and we use a different calculation system. So you get different level of points for playing class AAA as opposed to class AA as opposed to class single A. So Del Mar is still going to be in the middle and playing most of class AA. They're not really going to move up to the, because of their enrollment would still be low. So mathematically, it might not happen. Okay, so that's part of it that you do have to understand. So we know those concerns are out there, but again, the only real way we can address a lot of these concerns is to get this as a pilot program. So we can see, does it work or does it not work? Because right now it's just a guessing game if this is going to be an issue or not an issue. Okay, so what does it look like for girls basketball? Okay, so I'm going to show girls basketball up here first. I'm going to pass these out. You know, I'm always a teacher worried about it. When you pass things out, you lost everybody's attention because then they just look at the paper, right? But we're going to pass them out and see how it goes. I'll explain what I have in front of you. And I made 75 copies, and it looks like we might need some more. Okay, you have a little bit of flexibility there based on you know, the experts looking at the numbers and seeing what fits. I'm going to go back and forth a little bit here. Class AA, okay, and then class single A. So right away, this is just what the numbers show. This is not, we sent this out to somebody and said, somebody may say right away, I don't want to be there, right? If you go to class AA, Conrad right away may say, I think I got a better team this year. I want to be in class AAA. Okay, so they didn't have, that's why they're in red. Milford, I already got some feedback from Milford. They said, we wouldn't belong there. Okay, so they could already say we want to be someplace else. So that's why they're in red. There's flexibility there for them to move right on the bat before anything happens, okay, or after when they submit. So we broke them into north and south based on, again, geographic location to help a little bit with the travel because there were concerns with the travel. Okay, so that's class AAA, class AA, and class single A. This gives the new schools that don't have a lot of data, a lot of historical stuff, time to come in, build a program, move up and down. So, what's the schedule look like then? So there's a lot of options that we threw around. We looked at 14-3-3, which is you would have 14 district classes. If you remember, this is your district. So you can play 14 games in your district, 3 crossover games, okay, and then have 3 open games. We talked about that. We talked about 7-4-9, only 7 classes in your district, 4 crossover and 9 open. Then we thought, well, then we're getting into the whole playing, how many people do we need to play again? So we went back to what we thought was a good option, again, leaving the committee right now, 15 class games, so you're going to play both sides of your districts. You're going to play 5 open games. That's who you can play wherever you want. And a bonus tournament. Okay? That won't count in your 20 games. So again, we have some boys basketball tournaments. Girls Diamond Fades is one that comes to mind. You can go play in that tournament. Doesn't count against your game max. Doesn't count against your tournament seeding. Okay? You can go play in a tournament that's high level. If you think you're a high level team, you can go play in a small tournament if you're just trying to get some good experience.
How many games is a tournament? Was that about 1 or 2 games?
Probably like a standard tournament, like 2-3 game tournament. Yeah, 1-3, 2-3. 15 class games would be the games that determine your tournament berth. 5 open games do not. So again, you don't have to worry about going out and say, you know, I have to go out and play this team because the superintendent said I did, but I don't want to play them because now they're bringing down my tournament index. You don't have to worry about that because that game's not going to impact your tournament index. Just your 15 class games would impact your tournament index. So we did 2 schedules on the back of your girls one, and then the boys is basically the same thing. So we took the Concord girls and the Cape Henlisten girls. And if you see them, they're both in triple X. And we made up what their schedule would look like in 2019-2020. And then I showed you what their schedule is this year that just finished, 2017-2018. Okay, so what the committee would do is kind of what those first 3 boxes on that show. I think I put this one here. Yeah. Okay, so here's by the week. So obviously this first Tuesday, with my misspelling up there, but I still forgot to correct, you can't play because the season hasn't started yet. But the first week is open. And then the second week of the tournament of the schedule is open. So this is where you schedule whatever games you want. Some people like to, you know, play teams that work into the year. That's open. Then we give you the games. So they're playing at Sanford, they're playing Sussex Center. We decide the next 2 weeks would be open again, because that's a lot where a lot of holiday tournaments take place. That's where some schools like to have an extended vacation, go away for 2 weeks, they can't play any games. So we're going to open it. We're not going to lock you into a time when your school's on vacation. Then they come back, they're playing at Charter, Apo, at Sandy's, at Smyrna. Another open day in there. Milford at, so you can carry them through. These opens will be the same opens on everyone's schedule. Okay, so I'm open, you're open, we can play. Okay, not I'm open week 5, you're open week 10, you can't play. Everybody's open the same weeks. Okay, so the way this stands, it was only 15 games, 10 of these turned out to be away, 5 home. So again, worried about the travel, you pick the 5 games you pick up, you gotta see what you can do. You know, hopefully you can make them home so you're not traveling a lot. And you have flexibility in here, okay? We're telling you you have to play William Penn and CR. We put them on Tuesday and Thursday. First of all, we've got to make sure that we're not overloading the officials, or we're not scheduling all games on Tuesday and Thursday. This is just for example purposes. Okay, you may say, we're playing Monday, Wednesday. They may say, we need to play Tuesday, Friday. Okay, you know, Caesarotti may say, Conker may say, I can't travel to Caesarotti on a Thursday night because it's school night. Can we play on Friday? Can we do that on Saturday morning? You have flexibility within that week, okay? And if you can't get it to work, then you have other openings to work. So we're not going to lock and set you on that exact day you have to play. We're giving you 15 games that you have to play. We're giving you the 15 spots that we think will work the best. Then you can move around, and your AD picks up the last spot for you. Okay? So again, 15 class games, 5 openings with 8 possible slots really to fit them into. A bonus tournament that fills in there. Ability to move games, you know, Friday, Saturday, if you have to travel. You can move home and away if it works better for you guys. And then the things that are highlighted, I just wanted to show, like, currently, Concord girls traveled out of the county to the one out-of-state game. Here they're traveling out of the county for 2 games, actually 3 if I count tomorrow. Sorry, that was an earlier date. And then the same thing for the Cape Town Legend girls. So that's a sample schedule of what it would look like. Okay, and then, so what do we do come tournament time? Okay, so each class would have a tournament. Who gets into the tournament? We know that the class AA, right now, 10 of those 20 teams were in the 2018 tournament. So if we said only 12 of them are getting into the tournament, we may not be leaving anybody out who already got into the tournament. Okay? They can do an open tournament. They can pick the top 8. They can pick the top 12. Again, I think the first years is a little trial and error to see what's said. I would say as we move down the line, an 8-12 team tournament would be fine. Class AA, class single A, same thing, 8 or 12 team tournament. 9 of the 20 teams made the 2018 tournament. They went 10-8 in the tournament. And 5 of 21 made the tournament and they went 2-5. Just so you know where they stood in the tournament. If you look at the girls' basketball tournament now, again, great tournament, but there are a lot of very lopsided games in there. Okay? So what we're hoping is with a little bit of reshuffling, we can allow those same teams to get into the tournament and compete, but have a more competitive game. Okay? Because we're going to group people by their abilities. So what we're asking again, I'm going to give time for questions, but I talked longer than I thought I was. Sorry. This is our timeline. So we're still in this winter 2018 where we're trying to get the board approval. We're trying to make sure we get as much input from you as we possibly can. So after this meeting, these handouts will be sent to you electronically. The PowerPoint will be sent to you electronically. There's some other handouts that are all going to be sent to you electronically. I'm videoing myself for all the people who said I didn't get to come and didn't get to hear it. So if you know anybody who still wants to hear it again, they can go online and watch it. We'll send that out. And then you're going to be sent a survey that asks you some questions to get your feedback. It's not a vote. We're going to be very careful to make sure everybody understands that you're not voting yes or no. You're going to give us the input and your level of support so we can pass that on to the DIA board so that they can make a decision. And then hopefully, if we get the permission again to pilot this, this isn't set in stone for the rest of eternity in the state of Delaware for basketball, but we want to pilot it so we can see what works and what doesn't work. We can take it through, and we want to be going 19-20 season. Okay, so again, I know it's a big mind shift. It's a really change in the way we've been doing things, but again, you know, we are a different state. We are a different high school sports have evolved, so we have to evolve as the leaders of high school sports. A lot of the stuff we've done in the past, we always say we're just putting a Band-Aid on it. We just keep putting a Band-Aid on something and we don't go back to what is the cause of this. Okay, and we truly believe if we can get our hands on creating schedules and creating fair competition at the schedule level, that will ripple effect down to having better, more competitive tournaments, better opportunities for our student athletes, which is ultimately our goal. Anybody who has been, who is on the realignment committee that's here, that wants to chime in and say something that I missed? Anybody have any questions that I can answer? I don't want to take too much of your meeting time because I know you have other things on your agenda, but if there's anything that I wasn't clear about or that you have a question about.
You said cheers is a bonus board because I like that idea, but say if I was in slam dunk for the week, I would not want that to be my bonus point because there's a lot of potential points in those games because of the team you play against. It's with laws, so you can be do your part of your, that would be part of your open games in that scenario. So,
so if you're going to play in two tournaments, you could say these are my open games and this is my tournament, but the beauty of it is that those open games aren't going to count anyway.
Okay.
Because we don't want, you know, someone to be like, again, creating the same problem. I have to go out and get five really good teams that have this record or else I can't get in the tournament. We're trying to avoid that. So whatever tournament you go to, it creates better players, better opportunities, better competition, but not necessarily impacts the tournament.
Okay.
And that bonus tournament would potentially be like any size?
Mm-hmm. I mean, most 1 to 3 games, right? Is there a tournament?
Yeah, there? Well, I grew up in Texas, and the way they do it, it's 23 games and three tournaments of any size.
Okay.
And so some of them are 18 tournaments, some of them are 32-team tournaments. Just kind of depends on where you go. I'm not expecting to play like a 32-team
right.
tournament, but if it was an 18 tournament and they guarantee 3 games, I don't have to worry about that counting against my game count.
So I would guess, and again, this is, I'm not, basketball is not my biggest area of specialty by any means, that the committee would decide which tournaments would be acceptable to be in there or not, the sports committee, and it would be a big list. We're not trying to, by any means, control too much, but if there was a, hey, I'm going to go to this tournament and play 20 games, we'd be like, maybe not. You know what I mean? So we want to balance it.
Jerry, how much... I had some conversation with our superintendent. How much do the superintendents have to say yay or nay about this?
So again, the whole process is tricky, and Jeremy's laughing at me, because again, we just want their input. I'd have a hard time believing that the DIA board would be like, oh yes, we're gonna pass something that all the superintendents said no to. You know, you want the support of people, but ultimately the decision is up to the DIA board. 2 superintendents sit on the board. So we've gotten the feedback from the superintendents. We're hoping that they're going to give additional feedback because we've been able to go back and answer some of their questions. But nobody gets to vote except the DIA board. So everybody's input is being asked for, but no one gets to vote except them. Jeremy, you want to answer differently, or does that make sense? I mean, that's something that we're really struggling with is like, well, whose say is the most important? And we go back to the DIA board's say is the most important, but they want, and they've charged me in this committee to go back and get as much feedback as I can possibly get, because they know this is a big change and they're not taking it lightly, so they want to make sure they have enough support from enough people. That makes sense?
Yeah. So as a coach, agree or disagree, your input is taken, but the choice of what happens or not has nothing to do with us.
It's not your sole decision.
It's not a decision at all.
Well, your input's going to be appreciated.
Now you're saying you're doing this for fair competition. Is that why we're doing all this?
Right. Create those back to the goals and back what's on the sheet. Improve the scheduling process. Create fair, balanced competition.
Now.
Increase motivation.
When you say that, does that mean that you should, I guess, divide boys and girls separately when you talk about fair competition? Because, I mean, I know Coach might be in here, but I'm going to be honest with you. There is no way I thought St. E's would do what they did, and he did a hell of a job. But for the boys' side, I think it's kind of, I don't want to say fair, but I think it's a little different on the boys' side than it is the girl side. And when you do this, it's like when I look at it, volleyball, they still have 1 tournament. Baseball, what you did was you added a couple of more teams. Have you even thought about maybe adding more teams to the boys' side
The philosophy of the realignment committee is those are all band-aids and they're not solving the problem. We can make every tournament bigger. We can make every tournament an open tournament. But does that go back and solve the root problem?
Well, that's what I'm saying. So would you ever think of, okay, well, the girls have this issue. Like, if you go to UD, the boys' three-point line, the college three-point line at the University of Delaware now is going to be different. And it's going to be different than the high school three-point line. So now, if the girls have to shoot from the same one as the boys, even though it's, you know what I'm saying? Like, certain rules are going to be different. So I'm wondering if you're going to change, like, the group, like, for, like, you're talking
about
the competition.
So the boys is on here. The boys and girls won't be aligned the same way. The boys' alignment is going to be completely different than the girls' alignment.
Right.
But they're going to, yeah, one of the goals is to try to create more consistency with the way everything's done.
So
we
now you're talking about, if our girl, like, I'm looking at what you have, the boys are in, I guess, the two division, and the girls are in the one, or the lower one. If you do that, does that now it's up to the athletic team? Like, you talk about these open games and makeup games. Usually, if Caesar Rodney plays Middletown, the boys are home, the girls
right.
are away. Now we're in two different
correct.
Whatever.
You may not be able to do that anymore. That was one of the, under the concerns with travel, the traveling together, girls and boys opposite.
And practice times and all of that was considered? Like, if your school has one gym,
that's why, again, that's why we want to do the pilot so we can see. On paper, that looks like it could be a real issue, but is that something that we can resolve once we actually get into it?
I don't think we can resolve it. I think it's going to be a problem.
Okay.
Because we only have one gym.
Now, the groups are not even in size.
Correct.
Is that for a purpose?
The way the groups are divided would be up to the committee when they look at the data. And yeah, we're not going to just go third, third, third. We want to create a balance between, you know, where is the good line, the cutoff line. This was just all for demonstration purposes. And once the committee gets in there, they could change it up a little bit.
I looked at some of the Rhode Island, and they're very specific about their committee or whatever it is, commission. They assign the schools to the divisions.
Yes, and that's what all this is doing.
Okay, but I heard you say that if I was in a school that didn't want to be in that division, then I'm going to appeal or send something that says,
right.
I don't want to be in AAA, I want to be in one. And so you don't have any overall supervision of the teams. I mean, you still
so you can petition to the commission group that we call the sports committee to move up or to down. They grant that yes or no. So, you know, we don't want craziness happening where, you know, somebody wants to go way down and, you know, obviously you can compete at this level. So not everything's automatic, but everybody has the ability to do that as long as the committee can maintain balance with it.
How long do you have to stay in the division?
It's a 2-year cycle, just like it is now with our cycle.
And there's schools on here that they don't ever play in the tournament, but they're in a group, so they just choose not to be in a dorm.
I don't understand. What do you mean?
Well, like in the second group I'm looking at, Aquinas does not play in the tournament. That's their choice.
Right.
So would you have to play them if you're in that division?
Yes. Yeah, so they can choose not to participate in that schedule, then they can't participate in the tournament. We put them in there because their schedule is there. So if they wanted to come in and participate, they could. But if they said, no, we're opting out like they do now, they opt out from the whole schedule.
Okay, so if they opt out and want to play other people, and they don't want to play out these people, and then they're not in the tournament.
Then they're not in the tournament, correct.
The point system will be different than what it is now?
Yes. Because it would be based on your record in your class, based on opponents you're playing in and what class they're in.
So when we have, like we have now, a top 15 and a all conference and all like that, or is all that done?
You can have an all class, you can have an all district. Conferences are more than welcome to create a conference team. It would just be a little bit different process, but we're not telling a conference that you can or cannot have a conference team. We're not telling a conference you can or cannot have a conference champion. We're giving opportunities for other class champions, district champions, class teams, district teams.
If somebody opts up, does that knock somebody up, down, or are you just adding an extra team to that?
Either or. It could go up and make what look like a good 19, a 20, or somebody would want to have to go down. And you could only go down if you're in a certain percentage of the bottom and a certain percentage of the top to move up after that initial request.
So it wouldn't be like automatically the last team that was on the bottom would get the option to move down if a team opted up?
No, in Rhode Island originally, it's like the bottom 20% or the top 20% can move if they want. And that's something that, because we're basing this on different kind of data, we'd have to like work through. Again, which is why we're asking for the pilot to try to work through some of the things.
So say three teams opt up. It's not necessarily any team will move down.
No,
or how's it determined who would move down?
Certain teams will only have the ability to move down, and if they don't
that
move down, then
20%.
Those teams may not be able to move up. That would
So
happen.
Somebody would have to move in order for them to move up?
Depending on to maintain the balance of
gotcha.
The numbers.
Okay.
Right.
Thank you.
So like in this example, there are 20 teams in the AA.
Right.
So how is it determined what 15 teams you would play? Would they all be from your district first? So is that where district comes into play? Or
that's where district comes into play. So you can play your entire district and then the rest of them randomly assigned from the other district.
And then would randomly assign, that would be the sports committee?
That would be the sports committee.
I don't think they're going to be
We're assuming that we're playing all
so Conrad probably should stay.
Out of our 20 games, is that what we're assuming?
No, not at all. You have 15 games based on in-state teams, and you have 5 in bonus tournaments if you can do something else.
I know the bonus tournament.
Right.
But the 5 that are somewhere else, so I don't have to worry about those open leagues for those 5.
Correct. You play your 5.
Anytime I want. Because
right.
Some of the
we're giving you 8 possible slots, but you can play them whenever you want, as long as you're not need exceeding weekly min maximums and stuff like that. Right.
We play a conference that's predominantly Maryland schools. What would be the situation?
So you'd have to make a choice. If you wanted to compete in our tournament, you'd have to play those games. So if you could swing both and pick them up as your open games or as your bonus tournaments, but the idea is that to be in a tournament, you'd have to play the schedule that's being assigned. I don't want to take forever, but so I mean, you decide what the cutoff is, Mike, okay?
You have good for me.
Right, so that's what I'm saying. Like, I don't want
to,
so if you want me to stop,
I mean,
there's a lot more questions.
What is the best
reason? You can email me.
We do this once a year.
Individually.
So if you already paid the fall, you're good.
There was like a whiteboard. I passed out my card. Yeah, that's it. When I email the presentation, it's going to come through my sweat. I'll have my email address on there if you have other questions that you want to ask me. Go through the information again. Take the survey. Put your comments and questions in there. I'm happy to, you know, answer them. Like I said from the beginning, it is a change. We understand it's a change. Okay, that's why we're not taking it lightly. That's why it's been a 3-year conversation. What we're asking for is the opportunity to try it out to see if it works, if it doesn't work, and how we can resolve it, and then reevaluate.
Okay. Are you, when you have these 3 divisions, are you going to take some of those teams, say like the bottom team, the 2 that make it to their championship, say if you take 8, the 2 that make it to their championship, and then you got 12 in the other one, you take the top 4, are you going to have 1 tournament from those groups?
The idea would be to have for each different class to have its own tournament.
And that's it.
And
you're saying like in New Jersey to have a tournament of champions.
Right, and then they, and even Rhode Island I think has done that recently where each class championship plays each other. I'm not going to say yes or no. I don't know how that would evolve down the road. You know. It could be a possibility.
That's what they
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you.